that's where I belong. In your presence, oh Lord, my God.
It's a blessing of another brand new day to you. Our viewers out there, welcome to your favorite program in this presence, a program that talks about the Word of God and how we can apply the Word of God into our life so we can become a transformed, changed person from the old ways of life into the newness of life in Christ Jesus. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall all rejoice and be glad in it. And it's of the mercies of the Lord that the Lord has kept you and myself to witness another brand new day. We need to give all the praises, all the honor, all the adoration back on Him because He deserves our praise. If God can open our eyes to see the wiles of the enemies, then we know that it's only God that neither sleeps or slumbers. The Bible says the angel of the Lord encamp around about the defending name of the Lord. The Bible, according to Psalm 16, verse 11, says, "Thou will show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. And that is right, and their pleasures forevermore." I'm your host for today. I'm Akinkunle Akinola. And the topic I have before you on this glorious day is a question to you and to myself. We say, is why hunger? Why hunger? Joining us to discuss on our topic on this is Pastor Segun Adeyemo. That's the pastor in charge of World House International Christian Center in Pretoria, South Africa. He's here to discuss with us on this day. So it's another great privilege again for us to have you to come and discuss with us
on
this day.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. I don't take this for granted.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Amen. And the last time we had you in the studio, it was a wonderful time in God's presence. And we will know of the truth that God will also use you to speak His mind to His people on this day in Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you.
So before we actually go into our topic for today, which is why hunger, let's start with the mandate God gave to World House International Christian Center, located in Pretoria, South Africa.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Greeting to all viewers at home and also to my host. I can thank you again for hosting us. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much. The mandate that God gave to World House is to raise and develop leaders, to raise role models into societies that will conquer in all areas of their life, based upon the undiluted Word of God. That is why we actually call it the Word House. We believe the Word of God is everything. Through the Word of God, the whole creation was birthed through the Word of God. And that, just like the Bible said in the book of John 1:1, it said in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God, and that Word became flesh. So we believe that in the power of the Word of God. And that is what our mandate is, to raise role models and leaders that will conquer in all areas based upon the undiluted Word of God.
Amen. That's a powerful answer, Professor. So now talking about the applications of the Word of God. Let's say, for example, now we have so many promises in the Word of God. And we also know that we as individuals, our life is actually guided by the Word of God. Now talking about our own responsibility in that, actually allowing this Word of God to actually dwell on the inside of us, then we now apply the Word of God so that we get results in every facet of our lives.
Amen. Praise God. Like I said, the Word of God is everything. The Word of God is everything. The Word of God is life. That's why if we go back to that John 1:1 that I read earlier, it said the Word is life. Which means when anything comes in contact with that Word, it becomes alive. Even when he said to Prophet Ezekiel in the valley that was full of dry bones, what did he say? God says, speak. Speak to the dry bones. And immediately they come alive. Which means our Word carries life. As the Bible says, the power of life and death are in the power of the tongue, which means what we say carried life or death. Amen. That is why we must be very mindful or watchful of what we say. That is why Prophet Isaiah said, I speak the word, they go before me to fulfill that which I have said. Everything we say, whether positive or negative, they don't go away. That is why even, I'm not sure maybe if I can say this in my own local language, Yoruba says that any loro, Koseko, which means once you say a thing, it's there. That's why it carries life. Amen. And when as every child of God, I always say the Bible summarize the personality of God himself. That is why you cannot believe God, or you cannot believe in even in his power without understanding the word and also practically applying it in our life and also in our life situation. Amen.
Amen, amen, in Jesus' mighty name. That's so powerful and so profound. The word of God is life. Yes, so sir. If I accept the word of God in my life, then I become alive. Yes, hallelujah. That's absolutely so powerful and so profound,
absolutely,
sir. Amen. And so if you also are let's go on to our first music video. We'll be back with more for you. On our topic today, which is a question, continue to point out needs. As we come back with more for you, please stay with us. We'll be right back.
In your presence, that's where I belong. In your presence,
the shepherd can only shepherd the sheep. Obeying the instruction of the shepherd.
Welcome back from that first music video. And if you're just joining us, you're tuning into In His Presence on our topic today, Why Hunger With Us. And this is Pastor Segun Adeyemo. So before we actually went on the previous break, you actually shared with us the mandate God gave to White House International Christian Center in Pretoria. And you made the emphasis on the word of God. That's so powerful and so profound. Now, looking at our topic today, why hunger?
Mm-hmm. few days ago, I was having a discussion with some people. Actually, maybe ran into the discussion, and they were saying that if truly God exists, why is it that some are poor, some are wealthy? Why is there so much starvation? They look around some country like in South Sudan and say, why is there so much starvation? And all that. But I've come to realize the things of God is based on principle. And God will not violate his principle under any terms or condition. There are two aspects. Number one, there is the aspect of God promises. There's also the aspect of us doing. Amen. If we look at, there's a verse here that I would like to quote. Okay. It says, my soul shall be satisfied as with the marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips. That is Psalm 63, verse 5. This is a promise of God. Amen? Amen. And also, we look at Psalm 37, verse 3. It says, trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Amen. If we look at the shepherd, what does he do? It shepherds the sheep where there's a greener pasture. It shepherds them to where there is water, where there is provision. Now, there's an assignment for the shepherd, but there's another assignment for the sheep, which means the shepherd can only shepherd the sheep. Obeying the instruction of the shepherd lies with the sheep. That is why most of the time, Jesus Christ usually uses the example of the sheep and shepherd. Why? That is exactly the way God wants us to live our life or to obey him. When the shepherd is leading the sheep one will not go to Limpopo when the shepherd is saying, let's go to Polokwane. Because now, it's now down to the sheep that decided to go to Polokwane instead of Limpopo. So the sheep will not come back to blame the shepherd that I'm hungry. Why don't I have food to eat? So which means most of the time, the reason why the children of God still live in hunger or we still have a lot of hunger in the world today, can be likened to disobedience. Even though the God's promises are there, but obedience is down to us. And remember, God's promises is always there. It's just like when you have a TV, the channels, the signals, they are on 24 hours. Now, if you have it and you put it on your desk and you don't switch it on, you don't listen to the news, you don't hear it, will you blame the TV? Which means the activation of the promises of God is left for you. And remember, most of the time, God will not give instruction twice. God will only give instruction once, the remaining for you to obey. So most of the time when people live in poverty, is due to disobedience, even though the promises of God are there. So the promises of God are there, they never fail. God's confidence cannot be broken. The covenants are there. His words are yea and amen. They are there. So which means if God's promise and covenant is not working, it's not the fault of God. You need to find out where there's disobedience. That is one aspect of it. There's another aspect of which is down to us. There are a number of reasons why a number of people still live in poverty or even in hunger. Number one, even a lot of people even have this cultural belief that they have to live in poverty or in hunger before they can make heaven. So they believe you have to live in a particular way. You have to appear dirty. You have to deny yourself of good things of life. That is a show of righteousness. And that's what indicates that you are going to live heaven. Because they believe the more they try to be righteous, the more they try to deny themselves, then that's a sign that God will receive them. God doesn't have problem with affluence or with money. There's nothing wrong with being rich. There's nothing wrong with being wealthy. There's nothing wrong with money. What is wrong is us. What is wrong is our culture and our value towards money. People normally call this verse to say money is the root of all evil. You understand? The Bible says the love of money, which means is money taking the place of God in your life. Amen. Which means there are different gods. Money is a god. Amen. So if you put the God of money before God, that is what God has problems with. Not only for maybe with people maybe being wealthy, there are so many people that are wealthy here or not that will still make heaven. Even in the Bible, we see with our father of faith, Abraham was wealthy in cattle, in farms, in everything. Yet the Bible still called him the father of faith. Which means what is wrong is our attitude towards money. Nothing is wrong with money. But a lot of people have this belief. And as long as you don't have a cultural shift by having a positive cultural value towards money, you will never be able to rise above it, to be able to get money. Which means you need to have the right attitude towards it. So as long as your attitude towards it is wrong, you always live in poverty. If you believe it's a sin for you to have it, even when people bring something that should unlock your wealth, you say, because if I touch it, then I'm living a sinful life. So forever, you still see a lot of people, even a lot of believers, still living in abject poverty because culturally and in terms of value, they've rejected anything that has to do. And the Bible says in the book of 3 John, it said, may you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Which means God has no problem with the prosperity of your soul, of your body, and also of your entire being. God is interested in your prosperity, but your value towards money will make a difference whether you'll be wealthy and still be in Christ or not. And another aspect, why people still live in abject poverty or abject poverty is because of laziness. If you are lazy, you can never amount to anything. If you are lazy, definitely don't expect God give you promises. He didn't say, that is why he said faith without work is dead. Which means there are aspects of God's promises, there's another aspect for you doing it. The book of Proverbs says, a little sleep, a little slumber, and poverty shall come. Do you understand? So which means it's not about God. It's about the fact that you are lazy. If you are lazy, don't expect God to step in for you. If you are lazy, don't expect to eat whenever you like. Even the Bible says, even if you don't work and you are eating, what did he say? He said, you are what? You are the thief. Because he that does not work must not eat. If you don't work, you are not qualified to eat. So if you see people that are not eating, you need to check their work ethic. Are they lazy or not? Because if you are lazy, then don't expect food on your table. And don't expect to be rich. Amen.
Amen, amen, in Jesus' mighty name. And that's so powerful and so profound. Thank you very much. I was celebrating God in your life and so on yours out there. Let's continue on to our Bible reading. In 1 year, we'll be back with more for you. Still on our topic today, why hunger? Please stay with us. We'll be right back.
In your presence, that's where I belong. In your
everything is about trust, okay? The pain of the tithe is about trust.
Welcome back from that Bible reading. One individual joining us, you're tuning into this presence on our topic today, why hunger? So to go into our Bible reading for today, which is taken from the book of Proverbs chapter 19, verse 23 to 24. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 23 to 24. The Bible says, the fear of the Lord tendeth to life, and he that hath it shall abide satisfied. He shall not be visited with evil. A slothful man hideth his hands in his bosom, and will not so much as bring it to his mouth again.
Amen. A slothful man. It means a lazy man. If I want to use it in today's language, it means a lazy man. No man can amount to anything if you are lazy. And I've come to realize that a number of people are actually lazy mentally and physically. But there's nothing as dangerous or more dangerous than mental laziness. And the reason why a number of people are not breaking forth today or they're not achieving their destiny is because they are mentally lazy. You know, things are created twice. That first and foremost, the mental creation before the physical creation. So if you see someone that is lazy, he has first and foremost been lazy in his mind before the physical manifestation of the laziness. Amen. So we find out a number of people have not been able to break through in life, or they are still living in abject poverty because they are poor in their mind. And as long, that's why the Bible says, as a man thinking in his heart, so easy, which means as long as you are poor in your mind, no matter, you could even be swimming in the means of plenty, and you still remain poor. Okay. And one of the things I actually wanted to mention earlier before we went on break is the fact that one of the things that contributes to the number of people still living in poverty is because of reckless lifestyle and reckless spending. I always say this to people. For example, I've been in the finance industry for close to 10 years now, and currently I still work as well in the finance industry. And one of the areas that I'm working is the financial advisory, which means in terms of financial wellness, try to look at financial health and wellness of people, of our customers. And I've come to realize that one of the greatest mistakes that people make is the fact that it's not really the amount of money that comes into your hands, but what goes out. But a lot of people are so concerned, I want 100,000 paycheck. But as long as you keep a lot of tabs running here and there and not closed, even if you earn millions, you will still live even below someone that is earning 3,000 rent a month. So a lot of people, no more you spend recklessly, the more you live reckless lifestyle, don't expect not to live in poverty. You understand? Which means one of the things that will guarantee that you don't live a reckless life, Number one is to live a life that think about tomorrow. Anyone that cannot live a life that think about tomorrow will forever live a poor life. If we look at the story of Esau and Jacob, both of them primarily have the same heritage. But one lived his life recklessly, spent everything based on now. I'm talking of my mentality now. Because for him saying to his brother that, you know, don't care about my birthright, it means physically no one can take your place as the first son or the first daughter. No one can take your place physically, but it can be taken mentally. That's how it's find out some people, they're even the firstborn in the family, but they still live their life like the lastborn. They're still being spoon-fed because mentally they've turned themselves to the lastborn. And that is why the moment Esau made that arrangement, already automatically in his mindset, he has changed the order of his destiny. So a number of people that cannot live a life that will be able to delay gratification, that be able to spend within his means, that live a reckless lifestyle, will forever live in poverty.
Amen. So to go into the latter part of the Hope Universe, our Father in the Lord, Pastor E.E. Adeboye Rose.
Yes.
Also, some believers are hungry today because they have violated God's financial principles.
Very true.
For instance, if you are not faithfully paying your tithes, you are inviting the voracious to drive you into hunger. If you fail to pay your first fruits, you'll be giving the enemy legal grants to contest your job, open doors or breakthrough, and this could lead to hunger. Similarly, when you eat up your seeds you are meant to sow, after every provision that comes to you, you will lose the harvest that could keep you from starving tomorrow. I think this one we can also relate it to the aspect of we actually saving, like you actually mentioned, that we so many people, they keep so many taps running. So to continue, our Father in the Lord now further wrote, some believers are in hunger as a result of reckless spending. They want to spend everything they have in one day. If you eat up a month's provision in 1 week, you may have to spend the remaining weeks in hunger. In addition, some believers do not really trust in God, but in the quality of their certificate, wisdom, knowledge, and skill. This attitude has resulted in God stepping aside from their affairs in order to make them realize how little they can achieve by their limited strength. Hence, such people have ended up in disappointment and lack. Beyond this, others are in hunger because of laziness, as they have refused to take up opportunities to gather wealth. Lack of poverty may also be as a result of satanic manipulation and control. Are you hungry? It is caused by your actions or inactions. Arise and put things in order today and turn away from hunger and lack.
That's very powerful. I think basically it summarizes the whole discussion we've been having today. And there's another one aspect of it that that struck me in what you just read. The fact that a number of people depend less on God and rely on their own understanding. Okay? There's a passage in the book of Proverbs that says, okay, trust in the Lord and lean not on your own understanding. Which means God's promises are there. The degree by which you're willing to trust God, everything is about trust. Okay. The paying of the tithe is about trust. You understand? It's about trust. The first fruit, seed offering, your offering is all about trust, which means God is saying, trust me. So when we are saying, but in essence, if we withhold your tithe, what God is saying is that you don't trust me and in my principles and in my promises. So all things still bog down to to the mentality that you have. The Bible says, that is why I often say this to people. There is one thing that summarizes whatever you want to become. Okay? And it says, seek you first the kingdom of God, and every other thing shall be added unto you. It didn't say some things. He said every other thing, which means for you to seek that kingdom, for you to obey, then you need to trust. So it's only when you trust him, it's only when you put the kingdom first that you'll be able to say, whatever money I have belongs to God. It's only then you'll be able to say, whatever, even if you take away everything, I don't mind, I will give away everything to God. It's because you've come to trust him and you've become to hold. That is why sometimes the number of reasons why people are not breaking forth in life, where there's no breakthrough, because sometimes there are different tests you need to pass. Sometimes that even the test of giving. Sometimes God will say, if I give this man this much, how much of it can he willingly give out? When Abraham took Isaac to be offered as sacrifice, God was not interested in him sacrificing him. What God was interested in is in his trust and his obedience. That was what God was interested in. That I gave this man, this is my promise. Someone was saying to me the other day, the reason why I could do that was because there was Ishmael. But Ishmael was not the promise of God. Isaac was his promise. I'm sure if God has said Ishmael, in fact, Abraham would say, oh, well and good. After all, that's not the promise of God. But you know what it feels like? When God said to you, through this thing, you'll become rich. And God is saying the same thing, get rid of it or give it to me. Ishmael was not what God gave to Abraham. Ishmael was his own personal arrangement, was his own corner arrangement. It was not the promise of God. And God never told Abraham that through Ishmael will you become fathers of many nations, through Isaac. And God is saying that promise I'm giving you, you need to give it up. So God will test your willingness to obey when he summoned all this word I'm giving you. How willingly are you? Will you surrender it? God will test your ability. Even sometimes God will test your pride. God will say, if I give this man this breakthrough, how is he going to live? Because there are different kingdoms. There's a kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of God. The Bible says the kingdom of darkness, the men of the world lord it over themselves. But it says, in my kingdom, it shall not be so. Which means in my kingdom, the first will be the last. In my kingdom, whoever will lead will be the servant. In my kingdom, whatever you have does not make you to be greater than the rest. So we first of all test your heart, that when I give this man, is he going to use this substance to oppress others? And a number of people fail that test. There are some that God will just push. There used to be one of my mentors in London always says this story, that this man that was trusting and believing God for a brand new car. Every day he prayed, God, I want a brand new car. And God said, okay, no worry, just take this B2 car and manage it on the road to your greatness. And this man, with this B2 car, his wife can no longer say anything in the house. She said, I know it's my car. When this man gets into the car, as he's driving, he's looking at all the beautiful women left, right, and center. And God said, and the man said, God said, hey, this man, it's only a B2 car we gave him. What if you gave him a Mercedes Benz? Then what is going to happen to him? So sometimes God tests us with smaller things to see where our heart lies. So there's so many factors or so many reasons why even people of God are still living in poverty.
That's so powerful and so profound because of the life applications you actually gave onto this topic. Yes. We celebrate God in your life.
Amen.
And so if yours are there, let's continue on to our next week, which will be so our hymn. We'll be singing in 10, which says there shall be showers of blessing. Mm. Please stay with us, we'll be right back.
In your presence, that's where I belong. In your presence.
not desire us for us to live in poverty.
Welcome back from that hymn, and if you're just joining us, you're tuning into In His Presence on our topic today, Why Hunger? And this is the time of the program where we go into our memory verse. Our memory verse is taken from Psalm 63 and verse 5. The Bible says, my soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips.
So my soul shall be satisfied as if with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips. Which means the desire of God for his children to live the best quality of life. Was the promise of God. There's no two ways to it. God did not desire us for us to live in poverty. It's not God's desire to see his children suffer. It is desire for him to satisfy our lips with good things. Amen. That's why I said, I will lead you beside the still waters. And what happens, there's provision. That is why even when he created man, the first thing he thought of was provision. And he put him right in the midst of plenty so that he can have the best quality of life. If God has problems with his children living the best quality of life, I'm sure when Adam was created, he would have put him right in the desert where there's no water, where there's no food, so that he can continue to suffer until the days of his life. But his desire is so that we may prosper. Like one of my favorite verses in the Bible, 3 John 1, say, may you prosper even as your soul prospers. Which means it's God's desire that you prosper physically, and also that your soul also prosper in terms of righteousness.
Amen, amen, in Jesus' name. And so have you also heard that the key point today says, the child of a billionaire cannot be starving for what to eat. You are the child of the richest person in the universe. You should not lack anything good. Let's continue to our prophecy declaration with our Father in the Lord, Pastor E.A. Adeboye. Please stay with us. We'll be right back.
You will laugh at those who are laughing at you. Problems you are facing is not caused by outsiders, it's caused by relatives. Jesus himself said it, that a man's greatest foes will be they of his own household. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you ran away from home because of those inner enemies. I have good news for you. Because God is going to embrace you, all those enemies are going to be disappointed. Thank you, Father. It's a good day. It's a good day. Because Daddy asked me to tell someone here, he says, your days of begging are over. Yeah. You will never beg again. Let me just pick one of the stories. Some of you probably have heard them before. I went to the U.S. and I went to a bookshop to buy some books. And I was buying books, tapes, and so on. I had some of my children with me. And there was this American man there who saw the amount of books and tapes I was buying. And he came and said, what are you going to do with all these books and so on and so forth? Anyway, so he stretched forth his hand towards me and I shook his hand. As I shook his hand, he screamed, what happened? What? I quickly took away my hand and began to move away. And then he was talking to my children. Who is that man? They said, what is the problem? He said, I've had this pain, this back pain for years. The moment he shook my hand, the pain disappeared. Now that gave my children an opportunity to boast. You know how children boast about their father? What you are not, they say you are. Oh, that's our daddy. Our daddy is the greatest pastor on earth, etc., etc. So the man came to me and said, shake me again.
Welcome back from that prophecy declaration. I believe you've claimed every prophecy that has gone forth unto you. So before we let you go finally this episode, why hunger will be your final thoughts to our viewers on this topic?
Okay. Dear viewers, I don't know your status, your present situation and circumstances. I don't know, maybe you're living below the poverty line. I don't know whether you're suffering from one situation or the other. I don't know even when you wake up this morning, there's no food on your table. I don't know even when you are taking your meal today, you don't know where the next meal will come from. But I want you to realize that your Father in heaven desires that you live the good quality of life. His desires that your mouth will satisfy with good things. His desires that your soul prospers, even as you prosper in your health and also physically. His desires that you have the good and the best things of life. On this side of eternity, and even when you make heaven, you also. The Bible says, Jesus Christ said, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I wouldn't have told you. Which means even on the other side of eternity, is with affluence, and also with riches, and also with wealth. So God's desire is that we live a wealthy life, we live a good quality of life. But what I want to say is that maybe you need to sit down for one moment and take a kind of reflection. Look at your life. Look around you. What is the situation that is disconnecting you from your wealth, from your riches, from the good quality of life? Is it as a result of your disobedience to God? Is it as a result of leaning on your own understanding rather than leaning on the strength and believing God and trusting Him on His promises? Or depending on your own strength and maybe on your own flesh, and or your own knowledge or everything that you think you know? Or why are you in this current situation you are? Is it as a result of laziness? Is it as a result of reckless spending? Sit down, take a retrospection, have a reflection, and look around you. What is it that is contributing to what is happening around you today? Is it your disobedience to God? Is it your lifestyle? God bless you.
Amen. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you very much. I will celebrate God in your life and in our prayers that God will continue to increase in all sides in Jesus' name. And above all, thank you for making time to be
with us. Thank you very much. Always a pleasure.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. And to our viewers out there, Pastor Segun has actually given us everything that has to do with life applications. What we just have to do is just follow everything he has actually said. And I know the grace of God is there and sufficient for us to meet us in all our points of need. We really want to appreciate you for the time you spent to watch this program. I believe you'll be blessed in a mighty way. Perhaps you have any comment you want to leave with us, you can do that on our Facebook page. That's in His Presence, bracket, RTM bracket. If you have a mail you want to leave with us, you can do that on In His Presence at RedemptionTM.tv. I use this time out to say a very big thank you to our sponsors out there. That's McLeod G Farms, 1 John 5 4, House on the Rock in Johannesburg, South Africa, and of course the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the Master's Place. I leave you with that last music video as always, stating in God's presence. God bless you.